don't want to kill. We need to understand that when we come to the Gospel of John, we're coming to a very, very important work in Scripture. Most scholars believe and agree that it was the last of the Gospels written. Not everybody takes that position, but I am among those who do believe that John's Gospel was written after the other three. The other three being Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John was written for a purpose different from what the three synoptics were written. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are considered synoptic Gospels because they tell the same story with certain emphases being different. You know, maybe we're going to talk about Matthew. We take the book of Matthew, and what it does is it takes what's given, and Matthew's purpose, he's writing to Jewish readers. He's writing to prove that Jesus fulfilled all the prophecies necessary for him to be the Messiah. And that's vital. That is vital. Matthew does talk about the fact that Jesus is both God and man, but his emphasis is on the humanity of Christ. Luke takes a different approach. And that approach is to prove to the Gentiles, to explain to the Gentiles, to the Romans, to the Greeks. Luke, in fact, even opens up. I, Luke, am writing this to you. After having diligently studied and checked all the facts, he was writing so that the Gentiles, that's us, for most of us, could understand who Jesus was. And again, Luke did not deny the divinity of Christ, but his emphasis is on what Christ did as a man, what he taught as a man, and that he was a man. That's important. Sandwiched between those two in our Bibles is the Gospel of Mark. Mark is a much shorter book. Compared to the other three Gospels, Mark's definitely about two-thirds the length of any of the other three. And Mark's point of view was to show the actions of Christ. He includes the teachings, but his emphasis is on Christ did, Christ did, Christ did, Christ did, Christ did. Why? Again, a man does. A human being does. Again, Mark does not deny the divinity of Christ. All three bring it out. But those three don't, they emphasize humanity, the teachings, the doings. John is going to be different. John wants to prove that Jesus Christ, yes, was a man, but he was also and is also 100% God. And that is vital. That's probably more vital than many of the other things. Let's go ahead, we'll read the first 18 verses of the Gospel. And that I forgot to hand these out. That's why everybody's looking and saying, well, you're saying this, but where is it? If we happen to get anybody else walking in, we got, because that sometimes happens, we got hurt. I've done what I always do, or I almost always do. I can't say always, because I don't always do it. But most of the time, I provide the passage that we're looking at, primary passage, in multiple versions. We can read any one of the versions, and we're going to be fine. we might find slight little differences, but very slight, and it's how a word might be translated in one or two different directions, just like we talked about before. The word hot, how, what does that mean? It can be spicy, it can be hot that you burn yourself, it can be hot that it's exciting, and it's, you know, whatever. But it doesn't change the basic story. So let's start with chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. And then we're going to go back into a little bit more of the background behind the Gospel of John. John chapter 1, 1 through 18, reading from the Holman Christian Standard Bible. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were created through Him, and apart from Him, not one thing was created that had been created. Life was with Him, and that life was the light of them, of men, the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, yet the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man named John who was sent from God. He came as a witness to testify for the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. The true light who gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was created through him. Yet the world did not recognize him. He came to his own, and his own people did not believe in his name. They did not receive him, But to all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. The Word became flesh and took up residence among us. We observed his glory, the glory as the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him and exclaimed, "This was the one of whom I said, the one coming after me has surpassed me because he existed before me. Indeed, we have all received grace for after grace from his fullness. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the one and only Son, the one who is at the Father's side. He has revealed him." In the beginning was the Word. Logos. Logos is a lot more than just word. As we've seen before when we've looked at, or in other times, at trying to translate some of the words from Greek into English, we lose the significance of them. Word is, the Logos is a philosophical truth. It is argument. It is sustaining. It is spoken. It is written. And it is beyond. We know that it says in Genesis chapter 1, God spoke and it came into existence. 6 different days God spoke. God said, "Let there be light. And let the light be divided from the darkness." And it was so. 2 days later, the third day, God said, "Let there be a sun, let there be a moon, let there be stars," and it was so. God spoke. What do you speak? You speak a word. Now this passage is telling us that Jesus was the creator. Okay, well, let's go back to Genesis chapter 1 for a moment. Verse 26. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the livestock of the earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth. So God created man in his own image. He created him in the image of God. He created them male and female. Who he? This is Jesus Christ. He is the one who is doing the creation. The Father spoke. God the Father spoke and said, let's make man in our image. And so, he, meaning Jesus, created him, meaning humanity, in the image of God the Father. And we have that. Nothing that was created, has ever been created, was done so without Christ. Kind of a strong concept to consider. And life was in him. Life. All the fullness of life. The ability to create life, the ability to give life. We see Jesus out on the road. He's walking along, and here comes a funeral procession that we will come to later in John. And there's a woman whose son is dying. Her only son, and the woman's husband is already dead. This woman's got to go into abject poverty, can't do anything. And Jesus, hold up, rise up. You're still living. We see Jesus at the tomb of Lazarus. Lazarus, come forth. Continue to live. It's been said, and we've got nothing to contradict it, nothing to confirm it, that if Jesus had not singled out Lazarus at the tomb, anybody would have gotten up. I think that might be reading a little bit into it, but he certainly had the power and the ability to do so. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. This is not light and dark as in, oh, let's turn off the lights, go in a room, no windows, we're just in a solid room, you know. All we have is nothing but walls, we got no light. There, we stuck up anything, any light coming in from the doorway, nothing coming in, we're dark. Flick the light, what happens? Darkness leaves. But that's not the darkness here, because that darkness isn't trying to overcome the light. Sin. The willingness to follow after the enemy of God. That's the darkness that cannot extinguish the light of Christ. And then it says, a man named John. This is not talking about the writer of the gospel. This is talking about John the Baptist, who was the cousin of Jesus Christ. He came into the world. We're told in Luke, we have John's story in Luke. It wasn't necessary.
says in verse 5 of chapter 1, in the days of King Herod of Judea, there was a priest of Abijah's division named Zechariah. His wife was from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both were righteous in God's sight, living without blame according to all the commandments and requirements of the Lord. But they had no children. We read on down through this, and we see the angel Gabriel, the same angel that came to Mary, come to Zechariah as he's serving in the temple, in a place that no one else could go, so therefore he was in the Holy of Holies, which could only be entered once a year. And Gabriel says, your prayers have been heard, and you're going to have a child. Huh? You're going to have a child. Huh? I'm an old man. I'm 60, 70 years old. We're not old, old he is. Just that he was an old man and his wife that was past giving birth. Just like Abraham and
Sarah.
You're going to have a child. You will name him John. And he will be the forerunner of Christ. We have the story of how he goes out and into the desert. And he goes out to the Jordan River. And he's baptizing people there. And he's preaching and saying, there's one coming after me who is not worthy. Loosen the ties that tie my shoe to my foot.
I am not worthy
to loosen. Thank you for catching that. I am not worthy to loosen his tie. A slave was the one. The lowest slave in the household would be the one doing that job. And John is saying, I am not worthy to be the lowest. Who is this Jesus? It tells us more about Jesus the man. To all who did not receive him, damnation. But to all who did receive him, he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believed in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh. You know, not of blood. They did not have to be a Jewish person. They did not have to have a long ancestry going back. Not of the will of man. A man takes his wife and says, you're going to have a child. I don't want to have any children. I didn't ask, they're talking about back then. I didn't ask you what you wanted, woman. I told you what you're going to do. The other day, Lori and I watched an old musical, Yentl. And in the story of Yentl, a young woman, hid herself, cut off her hair, pretended to be a boy so that she could study the Word of God. And she fell in love with this other guy that she's studying with, but she never tells him. She ends up doing other things. Now, it comes along the point of the story. And the young man finds out, I've been in love with you all these years. I thought there was something wrong with me. Oh, no. Yeah, I'm a woman. Well, you know what? Let's get married. We'll go someplace else where nobody knows us. And you can be a dutiful little wife. And you can sit at home. And you can darn socks. And you can cook the meal, and I get to go to study. And she says, excuse me? He said, you will not mother my children, she says. I'd like to be a mother, but I'm not going to command you what to do. We have the same thing here. Not those born because some man said so. Not those born because of his ancestry. But those who were born to God because God said so. Word became flesh and took up residence among us. We observed his glory, the glory as the one and only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word became flesh. Now here it was talking about the Word is God. And it became flesh. And I'm reminded in Philippians, when Jesus, when it is written, thinking it not robbery to be equal with God, he set aside his Godhead and came down as a man. It says that John the Baptist, testified concerning him, saying, this is the one of whom I have said, the one coming after me has surpassed me because he existed before me. Indeed, we ought all receive grace from after his fullness. The law from Moses, and we're shown elsewhere in Scripture, that tells us the law is given for one purpose, to be our taskmaster and to show us that we cannot live for Christ. We cannot live on our own for God. No matter how much we try, we're not going to make it. In Romans, Paul wrote, if I had not known that covetousness, I think I said, I would not have known to covet if the law didn't say, don't do it. Here's a little experiment for y'all. I do not want you to think about that pink elephant that's wearing a tutu. What are y'all thinking about right now?
That very same thing.
I said, don't think about the elephant wearing a pink tutu. Or the pink elephant wearing a tutu. Man, you're all thinking about the elephant. The law did not be given to us to bring us to God's grace, but to show us that we needed God's grace. And Christ comes bringing that grace to us. Now, there's a lot more in here. But I want to back out. I want to back out a little bit and do what we talked about for those who were with me when we did our study Hebrews, when we did our study of Revelation. What's one of the first things we talked about? Who is the author? John does not identify himself anywhere within the book of John as being the Apostle John. Okay? So how do we know that it was? There's several points here. Matthew, the editor, who we've used in the past, he says, it doesn't matter to inquire when or where it was written or by who. We're sure that it was given by inspiration of God to John, the brother of James, one of the 12 apostles. Okay? Well, that's written out of the 1700s. But does that work for everybody? Yeah, in the Asbury Bible Commentary, it says, not go deep. Find it here. Sorry about that. Okay. All right, this is the better piece right here. This was written by W. Hall Harris III, who was a professor over 30 years at Dallas Theological Seminary. And every other year, he taught, as an elective, the Gospel of John. And he dig into it. Definitely a man whom we can take some information from. He says, theologians have found in the elevated Christology of John's Gospel one of the highest and fullest expressions of who John is and who Jesus is in the entire Bible. Christology, the study of Christ. The specific study of the doctrines related to Jesus Christ himself. John's gospel is one of the highest and fullest expressions in the entire Bible. Nothing tells us as clearly as this does. The text engages the reader with a subtle pressure to adopt the viewpoint of the evangelist about who Jesus is, forcing the reader to see the decision for or against Jesus Christ is an either or, which ultimately determines one's eternal destiny. As the characters in the narrative choose to follow Jesus Christ and thus choose eternal life, such as the Samaritan woman at the well and the royal official from Capernaum in chapter 4, the man who was born blind in chapter 9, or else reject him, as we see done by the Pharisees and the high priest. So the reader of the gospel is also drawn to make this incalculable choice. Someone, he notes here, I have never been able to determine with certainty who, so he cannot say who it was that said it. Once compared the fourth gospel to a pool of water so shallow at the edges that a child could wade in safely, and yet so deep at the center that an elephant could swim. This is an appropriate illustration because the Gospel of John is easy to understand on the surface, but has a depth to it that scholars who have spent their entire lives in the study of it have not fully exhausted. In other words, we can read John and read a good surface level and get fed to a degree. But if we take the time and really delve deep, we can never reach the bottom. We can never go so far into the Gospel of John that we can't find something new, something important. This is an appropriate, Hyrus goes on to say, this is an important or an appropriate illustration, because the Gospel of John is easy to understand at the surface, but has a depth to it that scholars have spent their entire lives in the study and never fully exhausted it. Eusebius, who was an early Christian, a writer, a scholar, historian, who recorded this, says that Irenaeus' authority for these statements was Polycarp. Okay. There are those who say that the Apostle John did not write the Gospel of John. There are those who say, oh, it was written by somebody else. It was written by, hey, Lazarus. We'll come to that one in a moment. Or, oh, it was written by a different guy named John. Or it was some of these that we'll read here in a moment. I consider nothing but a good joke. That's something to laugh at. That's how some people can be so stupid in trying to say, well, it wasn't written by the apostle. Why don't you go through this? Eusebius, who reported, as he read the 3rd, 4th century Christ, after Christ, says that Irenaeus' authority for these statements was Polycarp, who learned the truth from the apostle. Irenaeus is considered to be, if you will, starting with John the Apostle John, one of his underlings, one of his students who studied directly from him, was a man named Polycarp. One of Polycarp's immediate disciples who studied under Polycarp and took a position of leadership in the church when it was his time was Irenaeus. Were not very far separated from John the Apostle. Understand that. This is somebody who may have possibly have even met John before John died. Irenaeus' testimony has been discounted by many modern scholars, chiefly because they have concluded on other grounds that John the Apostle could not have written the gospel. They simply claim that Irenaeus' memory failed. Irenaeus didn't know what he was talking about. So I live in 2021. I think that's kind of like 2,000 years. A little bit less. I'm going to say, well, you know, this guy here, he knew John the Apostle possibly. He definitely knew Polycarp. Well, he didn't know what he's talking about. I know. Anybody know that? However, this presupposes that Irenaeus' only source of information was Polycarp. Now, Irenaeus became one of the major church leaders of his day. And his only source of information is Polycarp. But Irenaeus mentions an anonymous presbyter or bishop who most believe was his predecessor as the bishop of Lyon, France. Of course, it wasn't called France back then. Posinius. A man born well before the end of the first century. He died in approximately AD 77 at well over 90 years of age. Let me see. We did Revelation. We know that Revelation was written between 90 and 95 AD, probably about 95 AD. Okay. So John was still alive then, and he got out of Patmos, and he got back to Ephesus. Okay. Now, if Pomponius died in AD 177, at the age of 90, we're going to go back 90 years from there. So 77, that gives us, what, 13 more years? That puts us back to 87, before John got pushed out to Patmos. Also, Irenaeus was in close touch with Rome and must have known the traditions there. Scholar J. Brumman, a conservative scholar, states, critics speak of Irenaeus as though he had fallen out of the moon, paid two or three visits to Polycarp's lecture room, and had never known anyone else. He must have had numerous links. Irenaeus says it was written by John the Apostle. And we're going to have some scholars beginning in the 1700s and coming forward to today who say, oh, John could have done it, and Irenaeus didn't know what he was talking about. I think there's more proof that John wrote the Gospel of John than that he wrote Revelation. And we know for a fact he wrote Revelation. Other writers subsequent to Irenaeus assume the apostolic authorship of the gospel without question. People coming after Irenaeus, they had some overlap of time. Tertullian, Clement of Alexandria, Origen. If they were merely reporting Irenaeus' opinion in saying that the Apostle John wrote it, it's possible that they considered it worth reporting it that way without any suspicion. Then we have what's called the Eutorian canon. It's a document written about the last quarter of the second century. So we're at 175 thereabouts. With firm ties to Rome. That described the fourth gospel as preceding from John after vision given to Andrew that John should write and others revise. This is problematic for those who hold the late date of writing, but in light of the probability that Andrew did not survive that long, but this could probably indicate that John was associated with the gospel while in Rome. Meaning, scholars, church leaders, and who were in Rome, Alexandria, and other places, they all said John wrote it. Okay, so what are other possibilities for this? The number one, there was somebody living in Jerusalem who also had the name of John, well, with a common name, but not the apostle. And, well, maybe he wrote it. That was suggested in 1889. 1800 years after that. The fourth gospel is a pseudographical work. Pseudographical. This means somebody else writes it and puts somebody else's name on it. We have a pseudographical work from that time frame. We have the gospel, we have the book of Enoch, which does get referred to in scripture. We do in Jude's letter. We have other writings that would say, well, Peter wrote this, even though Peter didn't. Because if we say this person wrote it, then it makes it more important and more acceptable. There's problems with this, that John being a pseudepigraphal work. The view holds that all eyewitness details are merely a device to create the impression of apostolic authorship. And then everything John reports is having seen, he didn't see it. He just wrote it that way. Although the work was not really written by the apostle, but why did the author, intending to write a pseudepigraphal work, not just mention Apostle John's name? All other pseudepigraphal mention the guy's name that they want to pretend to be. Further, how can this theory explain how the gospel gained acceptance generally? It was generally accepted in the church. Unless the gospel were at once assumed to be genuinely apostolic, it would have been increasingly difficult creating the impression as time went on, especially with the rise of Gnosticism. Gnosticism took and did all kinds of stuff. You've heard of the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Mary Magdalene. If you read them, it's like no way that could be written. Anybody could believe that stuff. But they did. The fourth gospel was a favorite of the Gnostics. They took to that. Said, yeah, this supports our position, even though it didn't. So, if it was pseudepigraphal, it would have been cast out by the main church right off the bat with everything else that was heresy. And if it had not been accepted as apostolic, there would have been considerable difficulty gaining later acceptance. Wasn't accepted in the early, very early church, it could never have gotten into our canon today. Oh, how about the fourth gospel written by John Mark? Do you know what gospel John Mark did write? He did write one. The Gospel of Mark. We know that John Mark wrote the Gospel of Mark. There's two totally, the style of writing, the word usages, and everything else, there is so much difference between Mark's gospel and how Mark wrote, and the way the Apostle John wrote. So that rules that one out. But where did that one come from? Oh, there's a guy named Wellhausen. I forget the exact dating of it, but for Wellhausen, late 1700s, early 1800s. You want to know what else he taught? Well, you see, yes, we have Genesis and Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy, but you see, what really happened is this guy wrote this piece of it, and then this guy wrote, said, no, you're messed up, and changed some stuff, and this guy said, oh, no, not right, and changed it. The question we come up with is, then when does it become the Word of God? Those who were at the Baptist church this morning, you heard me mention this, that he described this, but this was the lie. This was the heresy that we were made to learn so we could know what it was And then recently, more recently, in the early 2000s, you have Sanders and Carson Pearson Parker also claiming the same thing. Actually, not getting to a question. That was written in, they wrote in 1960. Okay. Well, maybe it was the elder John and the apostle John and the elder in the writing, and John the apostle gets the credit. Does that make any sense? I love this one. This one here, just to show you how stupid the liberals can be. Lazarus. Lazarus was really the author of the fourth gospel. A man named Floyd Filson proposed Lazarus as the author of the gospel in 1949. Lazarus is the one male figure of the gospel of which a woman has specifically said Jesus loved him. Okay, we can see that in there. We can look at chapter 11 and see that, that Jesus did love Lazarus. He loved a lot of people. But referring to the beloved apostle is more free, a different word for beloved, more used. The word for filio, which means brotherly love, the love that Christ had for Lazarus. But agape was the word that God is love, that surpasses all measuring, is what we use for the Apostle John. Filson continued to argue that the gospel was meant to be self-intelligible to readers, who, without the second century tradition, which described the gospel of John, the son of Zebedee, would have understood the beloved disciple to be a reference to Jesus' love for Lazarus. Developing the relationship between John and Lazarus, another man comes along who went so far as to suggest that Lazarus was a synonym, a false name, a nickname for John. And that after he was brought back from the dead by Jesus, oh, John the apostle died and Jesus brought him back. It seems incredible that if John died during Jesus' ministry and was resurrected by Christ, there would remain absolutely no trace of this in the synoptic accounts or tradition. In other words, if John the apostle had died, would not all of the writers have said, John the apostle died? So where do they come off? Where do these false teachers, may they have their lake placed in the lake of fire unless they repented of their sins? Who are we to say, oh, we know more than you did? You lived back then. You knew the man, but we know more than you. No, John the Apostle wrote the gospel. That's important for us today. Because John walked day by day from the time John the Baptist baptized Christ in the Jordan River. John the Apostle walked with Jesus day in and day out. Someone thinks that they, living almost 2,000 years later, know more than those who lived at the time. We can take what is written by John in this gospel, and we can go to the bank and say, thank you, Jesus. Do we need to know that? So why did John, what was his concern? We'll talk a little bit more about that next week. The thing to take to the bank. Why is John's gospel so different from the other three? And rise of Gnosticism and the rise of other false teachings was saying that Jesus was only a man. That Jesus and the Father were two totally distinct individuals. We could go into a whole thing on what Gnosticism is. It wouldn't do us a lot of good, other than academics. But he wrote it to contend for the faith. He wrote it to teach us about Christ, that Christ is 100% man and 100% God. That's probably the most important piece we can do here. There are a lot of other things here. I know we have gone over some time. As with any other study, I ask you to take the time to sit down and read the entire Gospel of John at a single setting. Jot to yourself the questions that come up because you're reading that, but don't go on a rabbit trail. Just read that as though you're reading it for the first time. Read it thoroughly. Read it all the way through. And see how many things come up that you missed because you read it chapter by chapter. The Gospel of John was not meant to be read chapter by chapter. We talked about it in the past. The chapters and verses of the Bible are man-made, and they were made 1,000 years plus after Christ. The original writing of John was just one block of text. Where do you stop? You don't. You get a letter from home. You get a letter from somebody you haven't seen in a long time. Back in the days when we needed letters, we didn't have all phones and we didn't have text messages and stuff. We would get, how many of you have ever written a 5 or 10 page letter to somebody? I can remember doing that. Been a long time. But did you want that person to read page 1 and then page 4 and then page 8 and page 2? Would it have made any sense to read it that way? Or would you want that person to read your letter all at one time and in order? Do that with the Gospel of John. This